I can see you guys. How are you guys doing?
Good, and you?
Good. This is a long time coming.
Yes. It's exciting.
Great. Excellent. Well, thank you. Welcome to the 720 show.
Thank you.
Excellent. Fantastic. So, hey, you know, I think this is great. This is the first time we're actually speaking ever. So it's great because we're actually sharing our conversation with the world. And that's how I like to roll. So that is fantastic. So why don't you tell me a little bit about yourself?
Yeah. So, well, we live in Ottawa, Orleans, so east part of Ottawa. And we used to live in London, where you are, I think. And yeah, we invest all across Canada and now USA as well. And
good.
We're a couple, so it's nice. Yeah. Investing as couples, and yeah, I'm not sure, like, we just enjoy. I know you were talking about mindset just before we came on, so yeah, I agree completely. It's so important not to have fear or limiting beliefs. It's something that's really helped us. Mm-hmm. we always think like, what's the worst that could happen? So worst case, we lose everything and we start over. So I'm like, well, let's go for it then. It's exciting.
Yeah, for sure, right? And I mean, it's so true, because a lot of people live in there's this gap or gain ideology, and the gap ideology is what if something bad happens? What if this? What if I lose everything? And a very minor bunch believe in the gain aspect, which is, if I do this, what do I have to gain? Mm-hmm. And it can be seen, like, I was talking to someone about this today, actually. And so, of course, my background is high ticket sales. The most important sale I got in my $80 million sales career at the time was a sale I lost for $100,000.
Oh, my.
And it was a $150,000 sale I lost, but it was the best learning experience for me. Mm. And that's so... I had to lose that in order to learn how to win.
Yeah, that's a big thing. Like, how much can you lose? And we read that a few years ago, like, millionaires lose, isn't it, hundreds of thousands, billionaires lose millions. And at first, when we're refinancing, okay, oh, we lost 5,000 here, and it kind of hurt at first, but then, oh, well, this is actually a privilege to lose this money. That means you're growing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Losing fat, I guess.
Yeah. It's so true. So true. Like, I mean, I'll give you an example. Like, my business, our businesses are, you know, we focus on the active side. Okay. And then, so because we have so much action going on, we know that you're not going to have unicorns every single time. And it's like buying stocks in the stock market. You just don't know until you get in. And if you're doing flips, you don't know until you rip out the drywall and you realize, oh no.
Surprise.
Right. Yeah. Surprise. Exactly.
But
and a lot of times, it doesn't matter how much you budget, what I call HF money, which is holy fuck money. It doesn't matter. And so we have a property that we actually have to, we're selling at a loss. But it doesn't, I'm not losing sleep over it, because we look at what we've gained from it and how much we've learned and how we've changed our processes and systems. And at the end of the day, it's not about us winning. We want to make sure our investors are winning. So our investors are still winning. They still get paid.
Oh, that's
good. Awesome.
Yeah. We're the ones taking it on the chin.
Yes.
But I see mold as in, you open the walls, you find mold or something bad. Let's say the place was tenanted and you're in Ontario. It's actually an opportunity to flip tenants. So could be bad, could be good.
That's a good way to look at mold.
Yeah.
Absolutely. You just don't know, right? So, well, that's cool, man. So, I do like the fact you brought up, like, I was talking about mindset, and that's my biggest thing, and that's why I go by the 7-2 mindset investor, because it was not the real estate, simply a vehicle.
Oh, yeah.
But totally. My mindset had to be reprogrammed, I'll put it that. Or wasn't even reprogrammed. It actually had to be dumped and then reloaded with a fresh new software type of thing in my head, right? Because I'm a firm believer, without that right mindset, you can, it's anything you do that's high performance, it can kill you. And when I say kill you, it can suffocate you.
Yeah, oh, absolutely. Yeah. You have to really be careful about your thoughts, like just waking up in the morning with the right mindset and making sure that otherwise you're not going to sleep at night.
No, that's it. I mean, because the more doors you add to your portfolio, I mean, if you start thinking about all the problems that could happen, it could really... like wake you up. You were talking about sleep patterns. Well, that can wreck your sleep patterns. You could be like shaking all night. So You have to think like, what's going to happen. Other people do it. So it's really, it's not that dangerous. It's not that hard. It's just one step at a time. And and also buying deals, like being uncomfortable, yes, but don't go like crazy. If you go from two doors, you don't go to 300 doors all at once. I mean, you have to do it in increments.
Yeah.
That's my belief anyway. And then you grow bigger and bigger and it gets easier.
Yeah, for sure. Well, and I agree with that. And, you know, it's funny because when I used to go to all these meetups and it was like, everybody seemed to be compensating for something else, if you know what I mean. how many doors do you have? How many doors do you have? And it's like one of my mentors said, there's one person that has the most doors and that's the guy that sells them at Home Depot.
Yeah, that's a lot of doors, like, yes.
You know, I've met some very successful real estate investors, and we'll call them real estate investors, that don't have any doors.
Yeah, no,
but they do.
Probably the best investors have zero doors because that's a lot less headaches. And, yeah. And like Airbnb, they're a hotel with no doors. So
that's
it. Amazon is a store with, well, now they have some inventory, but at first they had no inventory and no more successful stories. And we heard on another podcast today, who's the best real estate investor in the world? Like very, very best.
Okay.
Who's the most successful? Like,
I'd say it's McDonald's.
And, no,
that's what I said, but no, it's the banks.
The banks own.
Oh yeah.
Think about it. They own like 95% of Canada or most countries anyway. So whenever you get a mortgage, it's the bank really that's investing, and they think about the spread. So they get their money at 0.25% and they lend it to you at 1.5, which is how much? It's like 300-400% profit. They don't care and they don't own any doors really. So
And they're protected by the asset, because if you default on the mortgage, they have an asset that they could just turn back on, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, for sure. No, that's a great point. So I want to ask you about your journey, because you had mentioned something to me, which was You recently quit your 9-to-5 back in November, right?
Yeah, November 6th. I remember clearly.
Okay.
Campaign, and we're like, this is it. I'm done.
Great. Excellent. So what came first? Was it like getting into the real estate, and then was it mindset? Did you come into the mindset first, then to real estate, and then deciding to leave your job? Like how, if you could walk me through that.
Yeah, I guess the real estate came first. And then I thought, okay, let's do a 5-year plan for me to quit my job. And then 9 months later, I'm like, well, now's the time. Jennifer was like, one of us needs to leave and focus on this growing business. So yeah, it was just time. And then with COVID and everything, I'm like, I don't need a job anymore. So goodbye. I walked out. So that was it.
Right. Fantastic. And so, like there's a lot of people I speak to and they'll say like, you know, they want to leave their job and it's this fear, which fear is simply an assumption. And yeah, there's going to be points where, hey, you can't leave, like you're handcuffed and that kind of stuff, but you have to start preparing.
That's it. And your numbers, you were talking to someone else about numbers and stuff. Of course we did some research, like what's our number? How much money do I need to quit that job? And then can I reduce my expenses? Because my goal really was that freedom. Is it the money? Do I need a new car? No, I'm driving an old 2011 Versa and there's some lights flashing, but I don't drive it very often anymore. but I don't need it. And we have one good car. And
yeah, I think we kind of got to the point where the mindset was important, yes, but also we were losing out on deals because we couldn't go fast enough. You know, like if you're only doing it like a few hours in the evening, you just have so much energy in the day and you're like, okay, we lost this investor. We lost this deal because we couldn't move fast enough.
This is costing me millions.
This is costing us money for him to work. So
yes, I'm actually
moving on.
That's it. So, and the old car is the best tip when you're shopping for properties. You show up in a nasty old car and then the people are like, oh, they can't afford it. I'm like, yeah, we'll see about that one. And then how are you paying? Well, we're going to pay cash for this. And they're like, what? Well, it's
that's hilarious.
A car, so.
That's hilarious. Yeah, I'm fortunate. My team goes and takes care of the acquisitions for me because I don't want to be driving up in my Porsche. So,
well, that's it. Rent an old car or something. Or most of the times we don't go. That's something else. We never go to a building unless it's really been evaluated or it's yeah. interesting. Now I don't, we used to go in and take a look and test the water and stuff, but now, yeah, first of all, most of our deals are too far, so we can't even go.
Well, it's COVID as well.
Yeah, and with COVID, yes. And really, if you know what you're looking for, you don't even need to see it. If you have the power team in place, you don't have to see the building, because
yeah.
That is so true. Like, I mean, I was talking to Jeff Weibo, and so on our power team, and so we have locked up, we have an apartment building that's locked up. In Windsor, for example, it's 1.6 million, and it's 16 units, okay? So you're looking at, $100,000 a unit. And the numbers, we ran it through, like, we actually have financial, like, Josh Finley's team have actually run the numbers and said, like, this is decent with the lift. How many people want to go see the property? And it's like, you go see the property, and you've got to put in an extra $100,000 or whatever.
Yeah.
Does it really change it big time? No. I mean, because it's a long-term play.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly. Yeah, and that's something else. People think short-term, but because they always hear about flips and stuff. But, yeah, like when you get bigger, longer-term is better. And that's where the real wealth is long-term, mm-hmm. equity building and those elements. So a flip is quick cash. A wholesale is quick cash as well to help you get those deals that create the long-term wealth.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So let's talk, what is your strategy? Are you just doing one type of strategy? Do you have like a collage of different strategies that you're doing?
Strategy is fun.
Well, so. I would say it's mostly buy and hold. Like that's our biggest strategy, is buy and hold. We do a little bit of BRRRR. We kind of like almost fell on it by accident, really. But I think that's our two basic strategies.
We like to buy projects that are appealing to us. So is it interesting? Do I enjoy this project? Then yes, then that's kind of what we do. Like,
and I find that even if you're not doing the BRRRR, even if you're buying hold, I think you have to have a place that has a lift in it anyways. Yeah. Otherwise, you're not really getting a deal. But
no, that's it. You don't buy for buying. I mean, that's easy. And creating a deal, I think, is very important. So you look at places, and again, like Jennifer said, where's the lift? There's no lift, moving on. So, yeah.
Absolutely.
Increasing the value, increasing rents. That's why we like some markets where you can really increase rents, and there's no rules and very few laws concerning this. So we love those areas.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. You know, that is critical, right? I mean, and the thing is I tell people is as long as they're doing some sort of investment strategy, it's very easy to, when you come into this space, to get that shiny object syndrome, because someone's doing a video on this, and let's face it, let's be brutally honest, right? No one's talking about their failures. It's all about headlines. Look at me. Look at this. And I'm the first to say, hey, I lost money on this flip. That's okay. And because it is, at least it's taking action, right?
Yes. Yeah. Oh, we've made some mistakes.
Oh, boy.
Oh, my goodness.
But like you said, you want to invest in your mindset. But if you're losing money on a deal, that's kind of investing on your mindset, because you learn so many things from
what
that
not
mistake.
To do.
You definitely won't do it the same way twice.
No, and absolutely. Live, I mean, you buy a property and you do the stuff, and then, oops, this is not working out. Well, okay, but how do I get out? Exit strategies, we learned all about that. Like, whenever you buy a deal, we find you should have at least 3 exit strategies, 3 ways to kind of flip the deal somehow. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it's a great learning opportunity.
One thing that I've come to realize through my maturity as an investor, and it's simply maturity, because people are going to go through this, especially new investors, is we're always hoping that the climate will improve. We're hoping that that contractor that's doing the job is going to do a better job if you tell them. We're hoping this.
No.
No. You know what? Real estate has no emotions. Real estate doesn't care if you're crying or losing money. And that's a thing. So we've learned, you know, through our maturity, is if we have to listen to our gut, and if the numbers don't make sense, if something's off, we have to call it, stop it then. If that means we have to fire someone, we'll fire someone. It's business.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah, there's no friends in this, unfortunately. You can collaborate with people, but this is a business. So, yeah, you can be, even with tenants, I mean, you're not friends. It's a business. No, it's... I tell them when, well, the ones we see, we don't see them as much anymore, but we tell them when they move in, if you want to learn how to invest, I'm here to help you, but we're not friends. So here's the lease and the 16-page addendum and all the conditions. Yep. And this is what you're getting into.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, that's cool. So if you could share some, let's talk about the five most important tips you could share with a brand new or an early investor in real estate. What would that be? Five tips.
I would say the first one is a little bit what you touched upon, which would be to make sure that the numbers work, because I think that there is a lot of overpaying of certain things. People are new and they get excited about things, so don't overpay. That's
yeah,
one.
Stick to your price.
Know what a door is worth in your market and stick to that.
You were mentioning mm-hmm. 100,000 per door, I think I heard. So yeah, like if that's the market, that's do your market study, and if that's the price, that's it. Too bad. And it's, you don't need, like us, we're at a stage where we don't need to buy. Like that's what Jennifer said the other day. I was stressing out, we need to buy this place. It's like, do we really need to buy it? No, really, we don't need it. So
yeah.
If we don't buy it, whatever. That's one thing. Mm-hmm. Not the emotions as well.
Yeah.
So no emotional buying. It's really the numbers and all the fundamentals. What else?
I think another one would just don't listen to the sob stories.
Like yes.
If you're dealing with tenants, there's always a sob story. So
yeah,
skip the sob stories.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And like if you do your own tenant screening, that's when you're starting out, then don't, yeah, sob stories, but also they're on their best behavior on the first meeting. So if you don't like them, just say, oh, then
I lost your number, sorry.
Yeah, your references didn't come through. We had lots of applications. We had to make a choice. That's it.
Yeah, so, I think the fourth one would be, like you said, get a mentor. Get somebody who knows what they're doing, that knows what they're talking about. You don't want to just be listening to your Uncle Bob that bought a cottage 1 year, 50 mm-hmm. years ago, doesn't know what he's talking about.
And mm-hmm. take some risks. So like boring private money and stuff. It's all numbers. It's all relative. So when you talk to new people and you tell them, oh, I borrowed this money at 14 or 15% interest. And they're like, you're crazy. No, I'm not. This is how I managed to get to the next level. And
yeah.
I paid it off in
numbers
a
are
few
numbers.
Months. Yeah, it's numbers. If the deal can support all that money, I don't mind if I pay 75% interest. I'll put it on a credit card and get air miles if I could. So, well, air miles, that's kind of useless. I'll get PC points for groceries.
There you go.
So, yeah, I think the last one is just do it. Take action.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's so true. And I love what you said there. Like, I mean, so people ask me, you know, what are the three most important tips if they want to get into real estate investing? And I say that there's number one, get a mentor. Number two is get a mentor. And number three is listen to rule number one, number two. Right?
Okay. I love that.
So that's the first thing. But it's interesting about private money, right? Because people will lose their minds when you tell people like, oh yeah, I'm borrowing this money at 18%. And they're like, you're borrowing at what? And I'm like, yeah, well, the numbers make sense. I'm still making, you know, 25% on it. So it's about the spread. Mm-hmm. And but yet it's those very same people you're having a conversation with that actually will keep a balance on their credit card at 24.99% to buy shit they don't need.
That's it, exactly. If you can't afford it, don't buy it. This applies to all areas of life, including deals. So
yeah, absolutely. So, and I like what you said, have I at the last minute had to take cash out of my credit card to make something happen with real estate?
Okay.
Absolutely, I have. But it's all about the spread.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's all about the spread. If you're making money on that money, it's fine.
Yeah, exactly.
And it's all expenses. So on your income tax, you can claim that interest. So I don't care. It's all, it's the government in a way that pays for it. So anyway, it's bad, but well, not really. You're helping other people along the way as well. That's the thing I like about private lending. Is we're helping some people that maybe they're not ready for investing yet, or they don't want to get into it, but they want to do this kind of passive investing. So why not help them along the way? And they help us, so it's all good. It's
right. Win. So with your private lending, when you're doing private lending, do you need to be secured? Are you doing unsecured? How are you doing that?
We mostly do unsecured.
Yeah, we've done both.
Yeah, we've done both, but I prefer unsecured.
It's just easier.
Yeah.
Like I'm sure you know, it's easier.
And most people, yeah. I was shocked. I thought secured would be more
popular,
but it's the opposite. People love promissory notes and the fact that, well, the money stays in their pocket. So there's no lawyer involved. There's no like community trust or Olympia trust.
Yeah, it's just less complicated for everybody. And they can still seize your place if you don't pay them.
Yeah. Money, so. So in our, like we do show, okay, there's equity here and you could potentially put a lien here. It's just not done. So yes, I mean, do your due diligence and make sure you vet who you lend to. I mean, not everybody's trustworthy. And mm-hmm. also you should vet who you borrow from. So we put our lenders through some tests before we borrow from them. Mm-hmm. So we take our time and we meet with them many times and chat and then let it linger. And then we see how they react. And then do I want to deal with you for a few months or a year? that's a question for me as well. Like, do I want to work with you? So that's a big one.
Well, of course, you don't want to be borrowing from someone that's going to be asking you every month.
Where's my?
Oh, are we good to get the money back? Are we good? Are we good? It's like, you know. But I totally get it for the first timers. But you have to have that track record, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And start smaller. For sure. I mean, if you're starting like 25,000, isn't too bad. Then the next time 50, then 75, then 100. You also educate your lender. Okay, look, I'm trustworthy. I've reimbursed you, and now you can trust me with a double the amount, triple, and it's shocking. Then people open up and, hey, I have 600,000. Well, that's not so bad. Right. Let's keep talking.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, that's fantastic. So you mentioned before you're investing in the States. Whereabouts in the States are you investing?
Detroit, Michigan.
Yeah, so not far from there Windsor.
Yeah. So Windsor is nice, but it's a very hot market. So we're like, well, we'll cross the bridge and see opportunities. And we're buying basically free houses using other people's money. So it's a full burr and extra. And
it's a built-in burr?
Yeah, built-in burr. And we actually... very smart. We did a JV and our joint venture partners pays for the interest on the loans. So it's costing us zero. He pays all the closing costs, everything. So it's just amazing. So this is investing with this much money. It's really possible.
It is possible. Absolutely. People, like I said, it's like this, what you can buy real estate with no money, what you can, you know, borrow at this kind of money, like it's but at the end of the day, there's a price to be paid somewhere.
Yeah.
And that's it. But you have to earn that, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We are kind of giving up a share in our properties, but otherwise we wouldn't have them. So I find that price is very reasonable in my opinion.
You know what? And that's okay. That's where a lot of that mindset comes in too, because there's more than enough for everybody to share.
Yeah.
I was talking about this before. I don't like to hold grudges to people because it's not good for mindset, but I don't forget the ones that when I started and I was struggling and I had situations and I reached out to people in the network saying, hey, I got a plumbing issue. Can I borrow your handyman? It's like, no, they're too busy and didn't want to share.
Yeah.
I have a long memory, right? but I'm a firm believer of abundance, and I'm a firm believer that there's enough. And like I said, we took a hit on our flip, but our investors got paid.
Yeah. So
I could remember that.
Yeah.
I could have said we all break even, but I said, no, you guys take a profit.
Yeah.
And next time you call them for a flip that's actually profitable, then they know, okay, well, you're really trustworthy. You proved that you were trustworthy. And so that's worth a lot. And again, that's learning and the mentoring and all that. So
it's integrity, right? That's all we got at the end of this. You screw with one person, you screwed with everybody, and your reputation precedes you.
And this is a small network, so people don't realize, but I think we're like 5% of all of Canada or less. So it's like 5% of 5%. So the word gets out quickly. If you're not nice, people know.
Yeah.
That's true.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So what's next for you guys?
Oh, well, we're going to continue. We have 2 sixplexes under contract, so we're working away on that. It's a little bit more complicated with COVID.
Yeah, and phase two environmental with some old oil tanks, but we see some great potential.
And then we're going to continue in Detroit.
Yeah, Detroit. So we want to do probably 10 houses there this year, and then probably 10 other properties. And then we have some projects in Dominican Republic and Curacao as well. So nicer locales, and we can flee Ottawa.
We'll be able to fly out soon.
Yeah, or swim or something with the sharks. I don't know.
Absolutely, absolutely. Well, this has been awesome. I really appreciate this. So if someone wants to find you, what's the best way they can find you and get a hold of you?
Instagram. So we're quite active. We host.
He's active.
Yeah, I'm active. Jennifer likes to hide. That's why she's sitting there. But she's
I know my chair is
the same height as me.
Yes.
But anyway, Instagram. We host wine and real estate usually on Tuesday or Wednesday or Thursday nights.
Okay.
We like to have a nice glass of wine, so we should have one with you at some point if you like wine,
cognac
or something. And so that or Facebook or LinkedIn. And it's our company name, so FL Homes Corp. And FL is for Famille Lantier, so Lantier family in French. It's not my initials, so.
You'd like to tell everybody that.
Yeah, well, it looks like it's all about me.
For sure. Well, that's awesome. Well, I want to say thank you so much. And I want to say you keep on doing what you're doing. I'm watching. Your content is amazing. Keep leaning forward, and I'm just happy that we were able to finally connect here.
Yes, I know. Nice. It's almost a year in the making, but that's great.
It is, you know, and that's why, like, now, like, I made an announcement before you came on. I'm not sure if you caught it, but so, of course, I have the YouTube channel, I have podcasts, I have the lives going, and now what I'm doing is I'm doing a series of Q&A for people that want to come on. I'm giving people the opportunity to jump on the platform and ask questions about sales, about negotiation, about... And where this is coming from is also my long memory of, you know, everybody has to start somewhere.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, and there's a lot of people, they make it so quickly up in the world and they forget where they come from. And I never forget that. So for those that are just saying, hey, I don't even know how to get onto social media, I'm nervous about showing my face. It's like, I got you. You just come on and ask me a question. We'll be okay.
That's great. I've never seen anybody do that before.
No, it's very smart. Yeah. Like us, we started, we were like, we're going to do 3 minutes. And then we kept at it, then 5 minutes, then 10 minutes. And then we got more comfortable. It's still, a bit of a
work in
challenge.
Progress.
Yeah, work in progress. But that's
right.
Bro, like you come on live with you and 30 seconds, that's already a big achievement.
No, this is great. This is great. And, you know, and what I'm trying to do is, so what I've been doing with a lot of my content is, so I really focused on a lot of the interview style. And so I've been blessed. I've had one of the authors from The Secret on, or through the Netflix documentary. I've had some really phenomenal authors that I'm bringing on, really focusing on mindset with wealth generation. And it's interesting because most, as you start tapping into this greater sphere, the common question from their PR folks is that, well, what is your viewership? What is your, how many subscribers do you have and so forth?
Yeah.
And it wasn't until literally 3 weeks ago, I started asking people to subscribe or like my content. Because it was my mindset. I thought it was wrong by asking. So now I've learned I do have to ask because people want to, they just need a reminder. So for those of you that are still on, thank you so much for subscribing to my YouTube channel. It means a lot to me. So I can bring more people like Francois Jennifer on too, right? So
So
fantastic. Well, thanks again.
Great.
Thank you.
And have a great night.
Yes. A last tip before I leave. Sorry if I'm allowed, but that's my thing for me. I'm known for asking. Ask anything, ask away. The worst thing that can happen is people say no. But 90% of the time people say yes. So you're so right. Ask for people to subscribe, ask for money. Well, don't ask for money, offer an opportunity, but ask for deals, ask for referrals. This is the key to everything. So that's it.
Absolutely.
Great.
Absolutely. And for those of you on my platform, if you enjoyed this, make sure you follow my friends here on Instagram. Make sure you do that. And likewise, any of Francois and Jennifer's friends that are here, you know, follow my stuff. We're all about abundance here. So
yes, absolutely. Thank you so much. And
have
we'll see you again.
You guys take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.